But, you know, they, as unhappy as they were to see me, they were happy to see me. You know, because I said, when I found out, they said, well, the person took off, and I said, okay, okay, and what are they going to be? I don't know what they're going to be. I got them, you know, within about 10 or 15 minutes. They're sitting there with some other drunk in there, you know, tipping out of a paper bag, and I said, you need to come with me. He said, they're not going to detox. And I said, he's a big old guy. And I said, shut the fuck up. I said, do not make me mad. This is family business and you're not involved. She said, yeah, yeah. I said, now get up, let's get in the car, you know. So, but the good thing is when I got in the car, I had a CD, and the CD was one that had been burned for me by one of the guys that we had brought home, who had gone to treatment, who had gone back to dance, and he made a CD as a present. And that person heard the music, the person I picked up off the street that day. And that made the person able to get in the car and made them able for me to talk them into going into a detox facility, which they had to go to because they were inside of that home. So I stayed in the car, and I couldn't get anything in San Francisco, so I had to drag them down to South City. And then I called the person who made the CD, who brought the CD, and I said, I want you to know that you did a good deed. You know, even though you don't know it, you did a good deed. Because that your songs made that person get in the car. And they listened to that all the way down, you know, and all the way. And so you did a good deed. You helped, even though you didn't know you were going to help. You helped. You know, so it does. So you keep everything, you know. And that reminded both of them, you know, of what they have, not what they don't have. You know, so, because that was a very positive experience. You know, and I'm not afraid to go out and, or to do that. I think it needs to be done. You know, and I have to say the next time that person ran, by the time it was getting dark, they were calling me. And they did alter where they were a little bit. And unfortunately, it was a big night on the streets. There was hundreds of people, but I still bagged the person and got him in an SRO. You know, but it's, so it, you know, it does have, so that runaway was much better. Because that, the first runaway, they weren't calling, they weren't doing whatever. You know, the second one, they were. You know, so to me, that's an improvement. People could go, oh, well, it didn't work because they took off. I thought it worked pretty good, actually.
Part of the
healing,
the writing, it's compulsive. Mm-hmm. You know, so coming from a rehab, I know that by watching and learning that it's something they have no control over. So by giving them chance after chance after chance, they learn for themselves.
Well, you know, I think some of it is he's tired of looking at us, you know, just want to like a break. You kind of start feeling sorry.
I'm just going to remind you about the whole judicial system, because I've been a youth advocate for like a long period of time, but I go to court for some of the juveniles out in Martinica that get in trouble. And there are some that at times they might get up onto the federal level because of some of the, what they have done. Mm-hmm. This is in state court, this is in the tribal court, per se.
Mm-hmm.
How much advocacy can I do for them to make it better? I mean, you know, because I go to court, I show up every time they are in court, and there's one in particular that's going to be, they're proposing even to give, he's a juvenile still, he won't be an adult for a few months, but they're proposing to put two strikes against him. And and this young man melts every time I come around. I mean, we have a long history. And I know there's some healing. I mean, the cultural piece has been very absent for him. But what is like, as far as being an advocate, where I'm not stepping on toes, but I'm doing the best service that I can for this young person?
Is substances
domestic violence issue?
So, but there's still substance involved.
Yeah.
Now, our TCAP person that works with people that's incarcerated, will be inquiring, and myself also at times when I get people that are, that get picked up and I got charges, active charges. As a tribal court, we write recommendations and take upon ourselves the treatment aspect of that. You know, whether it be extensive or, usually it's extensive. By the time they hit the court system, it's like 6 months out to a year or whatever it's up to a year usually of treatment, which would be better. And if you sell it to them in a way that they know that jail or prison is not going to help a person. Very rarely has it helped anybody. Prison guards get good paychecks. But treatment is what's going to stop it from happening again. Now, if the person is going to end up going to jail or prison anyways, then you ask for a lighter. There's facilities they can go to where they can actually get treatment, and you can get out earlier if you go into a treatment center upon release. Those are options that we've been looking at and we've been working with, and they've been accepted in the court systems, and we've actually been able to stop people from going to prison several times here, and they're going into treatment. The thing is, we've been, like I said, working with probation, working with the courts, and if somebody's not toeing the line, you got to say, hey, this person's not toeing the line. And that way, the next person that comes up behind them, they'll say, hey, those guys are important here, they'll probably go ahead and do good with this person.
Yeah, I think the best thing you can do is try to work out a situation where, even if you say, let him do, 4 months here, or 3 months here, and then he hits 18, and say that we'll transition him into, say, Friendship House, which has a combined program of rehab and DV. So I would work on talking to Friendship House, I would work on presenting a written plan, and if you, they'll take anybody, but he has to be 18. Mm-hmm. So you can create a consequence for him by saying, you guys keep him till he's 18. Let me set up an intake interview for him and transfer him to that. And if he stays in that program for a year and is successful, would you take back one of those strikes? Because two strikes is really bad. I mean, he can go out and get, you know, shoplift and go away for the rest of his life, basically. So I would really concentrate on trying to trade that for one of those strikes. You know, but I would do, I would make the calls, I would set it up. I would, you know, have everything and have it in writing, and then the time that he's in there, I would have him, if they have meetings, start going to meetings, and I would see if there's anybody available to do. We're starting to set up some in custody therapy, you know, so that he can start working on what he needs to do, because he's a, you know, at his age, if he's already a frequent flyer, he's going to go to prison if you don't.
So, Abby, can he, since he's underage, can he get his record sealed? So
you can't seal strikes.
Okay.
And that was the whole fight about it. You can't, a couple of things you can't take
even
off.
Even if you're underage?
Right. You can't take strikes off, and you can't take a registered sex offender status off. So it's really important to operate with those things, and sometimes people think you can, but there's a couple of things that will follow you, and those two are the two classic ones that will come out with you as you come out of the system, juvenile system. So anything she can do to bargain away one of those strikes is really worth the effort.
Can you seal his record on other things?
You can seal on other things, but it won't really...
Won't really matter?
Not really. If you have two strikes and you come up to a sentencing judge, in some ways it's almost worse because...
Looks like you're hiding something.
Yeah, well... It isn't even that it looks like you're hiding it. Then they're free to go, well, he got two strikes for, you know, mass murder or something, as opposed to whatever he got his two strikes for. You know, so you'd almost have to unseal it so you could argue that it's not that bad. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So it's not, it's just a mess at that point.
Okay.
It's still up for discussion right now, and that's why I'm kind of saying, okay, what can I bring to the table?
And I think that's what you need to bring, and I think you need to call Friendship House and see, and set up an intake, and have part of the consequence have them do time, because if he's that close, frankly, he probably should. You know, he needs to start paying it back. And that's what I would do, you know, and make sure if he's up there, I know there's a couple of people who work up there who might want to, you know, rehab. If he's, you know, especially if he's your offer, you know, if he's not, we can try to get people in to see him, you know, on a regular basis, because we do send people up there and have consultants that would go in and talk to people and do, you know, that can help him work around those issues. Yeah. So one of our people can do that for you and with you, too, if he stays there.
But every time that I talk to him, when he kind of starts to get to that point when he's gonna, his anger, he lashes out, that's what gets him in trouble. And then I talk about spiritual stuff, it's like the whole place is.
Well, I think that's, you know, I think we have people in who will follow him and then you can talk with him back after, you know, but I think it's worth the effort. Mm-hmm. And we're not crazed about, I mean, our obligation is to serve tribal members, but if somebody happens to be in the same facility, when they're up there seeing somebody, we can work out in some fashion.
Yeah, that's what I do about my
reactors.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm not going to worry about something like that. So that's what I would do. People have questions? One of the things that we're trying to work on too is advocates for or getting money to create fellowships to put advocates into our court system. And the rules would be very similar to Case Managers, because I don't really, like I said, there's no point in making a game out of proving whether somebody did something wrong. But to me, I don't really see the point. You know, I think traditionally, if you ask somebody, they just tell you. They may not think it's wrong. And I prefer that approach, you know, and it's worked pretty well in our court. People generally just say what they've done, then they have a reason for it, and then you can adjust it or not adjust it, and then try to set it right, you know. But I don't think it's really helpful for the judge to go, okay, well, you're wrong, whatever. You know, it's really about how do you make it right in the whole community. It's not about, you know, whether I feel that you're wrong. You know, it's like, no, people really don't, you know, and it's sort of like, I mean, even in San Francisco, they'll come and they'll say, well, you tell my child to do that. I said, well, if they're not going to obey you, what makes you think they're going to obey me? They don't even know me. You know, so I said, we got to figure out how to make this work. I said, okay, they're not going to obey me. Maybe if I throw them in jail, but so what? You know, so we are working on advocates who can help people. It is really difficult to navigate the systems. I mean, sort of what you were saying, you know. Here's TANF, here's GE, here's SSI, here's this, here's that, here's food stamps, here's, you know, by the time you get done running that gamut, trying to figure out, you know, how to get the lunch, you just about wear yourself out. You know, so you do need people who can help work that and who can help work the system. You know, and they don't make it easy. So I do think it is worth having advocates who will do that and help you get done what you need to have done, or write the appeals that you need, or like what you're doing, you know, to go in and create an advocacy document for somebody who needs that help. You know, we have got a lot of people who are in need of help right now, and that's kind of how I look at it. You know, and so if you look at every person's situation and go, okay, what could I do to help that? You know, that's what I really see applicants' jobs are, you know, and how, you know, when we have camps at the dances and stuff, we bring people there to talk, and, you know, and then he runs the camps, and, you know, people, and you can say, okay, you're in rehab, but we're going to bring you home, and, you know, your grandma and your children can come and stay with you at the camp, and that's very helpful.